presents. How you all doing? The moment is here at last for me to do my video on Tabitha. I really needed the weekend to be able to process this and process my thoughts on Tabitha. So I'm going to do a video on the defense and on the attack of, because it is the thing, as much as people know I love Tabitha, I love his games, I'm not going to be coming on this video just blowing nothing but sunshine out of his ass and saying that there isn't actually a side to me that goes Tabitha's left, good. Because there is an element of that. But kicking off, so for anyone who doesn't know the update at this point, I always feel silly covering these videos when so many other YouTubers have got to me before it. Tabitha has left Square Enix, but also the Luminous Studio Productions, which he had just recently moved over to. I mean, as far as about 6 months to a year, Luminous Studios production wasn't even a thing. He's been headed up as the COO of it, and some of the things that they were planning to do within this division were pretty crazy and out there. I mean, crazy and out there. We're talking a AAA project, new IP that's twice the size of 15. That's what they were aiming for. They were even talking as far as things as like AI with souls. AI so advanced, so complex, so real and believable, that it's almost like they can make their own choices, as well as some other really out there stuff that, you know, I've been wary of. You know, I don't want to sound like a Neanderthal when I say, you know, I'm kind of against progression in the Final Fantasy series right now, because I'm not. I'm against progression at that kind of rate and degree. I'm at the stage where I'm just like, Final Fantasy, please take a step back. Take a step back and breathe. You know, focus on the story for a bit, focus on the feels, focus on what really is the main draw to Final Fantasy. You know, I always want Final Fantasy to be improving and moving forward, but Square Enix seem to take it a little bit too far, and I do not want to see this franchise used as a testing ground either, and I don't think a lot of fans do. I mean, when 7 Remake got announced and they said that it was going to be on Unreal Engine 4, you know, a refined engine that's used to create many, many, many games, I don't think I heard anyone come out and bemoan that. I just didn't hear anyone come out and say, oh, FF7, it deserves something new. It does, you know, it deserves something better than the average engine. Its graphical fidelity should be above. How dare Square Enix go for such a solid, reliable engine? In fact, it was a breath of relief. It was a sigh of relief for most fans, because the idea of Unreal Engine 4 gave us a lot of confidence that we might actually get this project. And in fact, it's when you went against that, Square Enix, now that they've said that they've gone back to the 7 Remake, don't know how I'm on that from Tabitha right now, but when they went back to the 7 Remake to try to increase its graphical fidelity to go back and make it look even better and swankier, which is in part why we have these delays, it's in part why they ditched some of their external developers, and that's likely one of the huge reasons why we have these delays now. So when it comes to that, when it comes to what Luminous is planning to do, and when it comes to, and I've got to agree, Tabitha was on board with that stuff, with this very revolutionary, far-reaching envisioning of what video games can achieve. He said he wants to do that. He wants to work within that. He wants to create something that he can put his stamp on, and I do not blame the man whatsoever. In fact, when we go through the history of what he's been on, what he's truly had to go through and overcome, and the slaps that he's had in his face, that it is no surprise we're now at this position where he's left Square Enix. Or they've kind of tied his hands up so much that they more or less forced him out. But Tabitha being Tabitha, he always takes the fall and the brunt of the responsibility for himself. And that's the one thing I can say, that if anyone disagrees on this, that Tabitha at any point has come out and bitched or bemoaned any of his role, or hasn't accepted responsibility as his role as director on 15, well, then it's bullshit. Sometimes I feel that Tabitha even takes way more responsibility than he really deserves to be taken or should be taken. me. God, I've got that really deep weekend voice. I can hear it. It probably sounds terrible on this mic. So when I started hearing that from Tabitha, I was thinking, you know, parting ways might be a good thing. It was also the case when he said that he wasn't interested in Final Fantasy at the end of Final Fantasy 15, which again, I don't blame him for. He's always said he wanted to go off and do some other stuff. So that's where Luminous Studio Productions really fitted in for him. Because now that's a very revolutionary, far-thinking, and I've got to say, out of its depth division that is designed and has always been designed to push the boundaries. And this is what I want to kind of bring to the table that most people seem to forget. Before Tabata came onto FF15, the decision for Luminous Studios when it was transitioning from Versus to 15 was made by Square Enix. This decision to create an engine that could rival the West, that's their own quote. That's a quote for Square Enix. They were doing it to compete with the West. They have been lagging. So when they made this, when they decided to go for this really bold, daring engine to push out their latest AAA game that they were very much willing to invest heavily in, to try to put themselves back on there as a lead in the AAA JRPG and even just game industry, none of that was Tabata's decision. And from day one, he would have had very little creative decision. I mean, on top of the fact that he already had very little creative decision because of what Nomura did, which we're going to get into the whole story for Nomura and Tabata. This two-way, it's not a rivalry because they actually very much like each other. Fans seem to treat it as a rivalry, even though they don't. But it goes way, way back and it's way, way more extensive. Just how much Tabata has had to live under Nomura's shadow. But the fact that Nomura had already got all these characters out, shown all this stuff, hyped this project up for years, not only in terms of character and story and, you know, creative design and artistic design and combat design, just about everything had Tabata's hands tied from the beginning at regard. And every step of the way that he's had to make changes or he's tried to make changes, we fans have given him a fucking shit time for it. Be that there's not enough Ravus in the game. You know, at the end of the day, Tabata probably would never have even wanted the character Ravus or never even created him. And you know what? There's probably loads of characters like that that honestly, if it was down to Tabata, wouldn't have been in the final game. That they were only there because Nomura showed them off and they were part of Nomura's story. And we saw that with Luna Freya over to Stella. So in terms of that, his hands were tied, but also in the fact that Luminous Studios engine. Now, do you really think that Square Enix, when they decided to bring on Tabata and said, we want you to make this really big, huge, competitive, out there, industry, game-changing game with this new engine we're willing to invest more than we can comfortably invest, do you really think they said, but feel free just to make a comfortable kind of semi-linear turn-based combat game. Feel free to do that. Feel free to just shoot straight down the line, nice and safe. No chance. They wanted, and the fact that even before they spoke about creating the engine to compete with the West, they were even talking about how they were looking at EA's business model on how...
Oh my God.
I still puke in my mouth when I hear that. They were looking at EA as an influence on how Western fans, what kind of games we wanted, what kinds of features we wanted. So Tabata, without a doubt, had to work within such a difficult paradigm from day one. Yes, I'm very much in the defensive now. From day one, Tabata had to pick up a game that had been put into the fucking trash bin. The entire staff were demoralized and demotivated. Unmotivated? I think that's the word. They were unmotivated, and Tabata, when he came aboard, he said he not only had to pick the team up, he had to pick the project up, on top of the fact that he then had to make exponential things happen with this game to warrant the use of this luminous engine they were creating. And again, as well as having his hands pretty tight creatively, is it any wonder that this man was driven to the point of stress and beyond? And the thing is, he never even worded it that way, but there were a few little articles that came out. They kind of slipped under the radar, no one really saw them. He was only sleeping for 3 hours most of the time that he was on the job. Now, I don't know about you guys, but honestly, if I have less than 5 hours sleep, I can't even create a YouTube video. I can't even sit looking like a scruffy-haired hobo twat that I am and just ramble in front of the camera in a coherent, eloquent way, let alone be able to run a team of 300 people on Square Enix's biggest project that's already been through a shitstorm that had the highest level of expectation and demand from both company and fans. Probably ever. Because fans have been waiting for it so long. The expectation was just so high. And he was simply overworked into the ground. The article I was talking about, a quote from Tabata, "You'd be appalled," says Hajime Tabata, director of Type-Zero and FF15. "Just as reference, I sleep maybe 3 hours each day. It's difficult every day. There is a sense that this is shortening my lifespan, but this is all worth it. Now, just to be clear, he's not saying this in a mopey, victimizing way. He was saying it in this interview with a smile on his face and a bit of a joke. But for and they even recognize it. The article writer says, for a man who jokes often about his work sending him to an early grave, Tabbitt is in great spirits, charismatic and sharp. He smiles and jests frequently. And just from a personal story, I've seen Tabitha twice. I actually got to actually hug him on one occasion. Whenever I've seen this man, the optimism and the enthusiasm and the smile and grin that he has for every fan he meets at every event, I've never seen it waver. Even though when I saw him, he did look haunted to the fucking grave. He looked so tired, yet his smile was bright and fresh. And this is kind of why I wanted to do this video, because we as fans sit and argue about Tabitha and Nomura. We argue about them as directors, and we fire all this shit at them just because they're director. No, director, he's at the top of the chain. Anything that goes wrong, fire him. And it's so easy to forget that these are just men. These are just human men who have no foresight into how these projects are going to pan out, how difficult they're going to be, the obstacles that they're going to overcome and they're going to have to adjust to, and just that they're human people with human minds and limits of their creativity and energy. And that's just so easily forgotten. So that's why I wanted to read this article. He also goes on to say, because this was at a period where both Type 0 and 15, the Type 0 HD came out so close to FF15, and he was having to have input on both of those. So he was even being stretched in that regard. If 15 wasn't already demanding enough, Type 0 HD was also having to take some of his attentions. But those two titles may come to define the franchise as its new era, but it's still unclear, even to Tabitha, exactly what kind of legacy they'll leave. He says, with Type 0 HD, we started the project because of our fans, so we want to ensure that we're able to deliver the experience for them properly. With 15, we're looking even further ahead and really want to make an evolved version of Final Fantasy. Once again, he said, we want to make, but no, this is what Square Enix needed him to make from day one. That was part of the deal. That was part of the contract when Tabitha came on board. And I see why they passed it from Nomura to Tabitha. They've done it so many times, passed off projects that should have been Nomura's. In fact, Tabitha has pretty much had all of his projects, at some point influenced by Nomura, first of all. And that little line he said there, man, I need to slow down my talking pace. I'm just so impassioned by this topic. Yeah, and just to finish this article, in terms of a franchise as a whole, there is no directive or clear direction that we're moving towards, what we're moving towards for this generation. So they had no idea where 15 was going to go. They needed to know that it needed to influence the generation, and it needed to be something to push them into the next generation of gaming, but they had no idea where it was, and there was no direction from anyone else. Tabitha had to try to figure it out, and he's getting 3 hours sleep, and even on top of that, he was saying his wife and kids, he hadn't seen them for ages. As a husband, as a father to a daughter who was in kindergarten at this point, it feels like he's never at home enough. He cranks into the early hours of the morning during the week, but then he has to rush back to try to spend some time playing with his daughter, eating with his wife. His own alone time is non-existent whatsoever. All he ever gets is when he gets to listen to music in his car. That's all he really does. That's the only place where he can find peace, is when he listens to music. Despite all of that, the way he saw it was that if he heard news of fans enjoying the game, then he said to him, it's all kind of worth it. That you forget about all the struggles that we face during the development, because that's what keeps me going. If I get to give fans something to cling on to, some entertainment that was helping people to keep their heads up so that they could have something to look forward to. And that's very much true. You know, that's not just a director just trying to sort of sunny side his own backside. No, he truly does care about the fans, and that even goes back to Type Zero. The clock was ticking on that, and they actually rushed to release the original Type Zero out. Tabitha went to Square Enix and asked if they could rush it out sooner, because I believe at the point of releasing, there had been a terrible disaster in Japan. There had been earthquakes. I think a few reactors had gone a bit nuclear. There'd been some sort of spillage. Like, there was a real crisis and a breakdown. He said that he wanted to get it out because he wanted those people who were going through hardships to be able to have the game and to be able to take their mind, if only for a brief time, away from what was happening at this point. He says he puts everything into all the titles he creates. Final Fantasy sticks in many people's memories, so if I'm bringing a positive outlook to those who are playing, if I'm delivering positive experience, then I guess yes, it'll be great to be remembered as someone who was part of the franchise. to me, I could sit here waffling on how Lumina Studios had just lost 33 million. I could waffle on whether, you know, Square Enix hoofed him out the door, you know, whether there was some sort of internal drama, you know, whether it all flared up. But I think at the end of the day, that's really it. I think that's what the words from Tabat himself, that as long as it was giving people a positive experience and it was making fans positive, then he would keep doing it. The way I see it, you know, and I don't want to say, oh, it's us fans' fault for Tabata leaving, but there has not been virtually any positive that could outweigh the negative that I've been seeing lately. Like, for those who are positive about Tabata, and even me, I think I'm probably a bit guilty of this, is you get kind of so bored of arguing with people who just want to take every single blame and fault that happened with 15 and just pin it on him. You know, certainly, were there some creative decisions I didn't agree with? Yes, I've said that many times. Were there some decisions that Tabata made that I think were shit? Yeah, I think there were. But I've always been objective enough to see the beauties of what he's bought, of what he overcame. You know, and for those who couldn't, they just go into overdrive and they just pin every fault on him. And that's the thing, you kind of get tired of arguing about that. So I feel like the positives about Tabata have very much dwindled from what I've seen. And the negatives have just kind of reigned supreme. The seesaw is of yore. I expect there's probably a vibe for like that in Japan as well. And the way I see it is, if Tabata saw that, well, then I think he would look at it as, this is no longer something negative. This is no longer something positive. Therefore, I don't want to have any part of it before, because he said he was only doing it if it was going to have a positive influence. And I definitely think that at the point when he knew, because he would have known earlier on that those three DLCs were getting cancelled, he would have known the fallout of that. He would have also known the 33 million, because don't you think it's a bit of a coincidence that they announced all of this at the same time? Like, Square Enix decided to do this apocalypse of news. I mean, it's no surprise, really. I've worked in many companies. Before I did YouTube, I worked in a huge aviation engineering company, and they did the same kind of shit. You have these big projects going, and you know, they all have their project booking numbers, and they all have their own little internal fiscal system, and those projects, they get juggled like a motherfucker. Like, they just get juggled. They just juggle the fees all the way up until the final point. And that loss might be offset there, and we'll just roll that over into that next fiscal thing. And until we've seen the results of that, we can't say whether that's a scrap or a loss. So we'll just hold that on the book for now. You know, that's how they ran their projects. It's seen how I've seen many companies run their projects, on top of the fact that they do. No, we used to call it massaging the numbers. Massaging the numbers. Because no one wants to clean up the shit themselves. Everyone wants to take a dump in the bowl, but then they just want to get out of there and leave it for someone else to clean later. And even that for shareholders, you know. The massaging the numbers, it keeps everything looking a bit more stable. You know, rather than announcing all of the losses at the point they're coming, which, you know, is multiple negative articles across a long time, and shareholders get hold of that and it creates a decline. I've seen it many times. They decide to sort of build up all of these issues, then announce them in one big wave in sort of 1 week, where hopefully only a few eyes will get onto it. You know, it'll only be once then and there, get all out of the way. Hopefully it'll go out over some people's fucking radar, and well, there might be a little drop in the stocks and whatnot. Is nothing too considerable. They always prefer doing it their way, massage it to the point where they just drop the bomb and then try to quickly move over it, like almost like a glossing over kind of thing. And they also like to sort of box everything into one sort of compartment of blame. And the thing is, it's real shitty. It's really, really shitty that the fact that they've decided to do this with Tabata, at the same time they've done the DLC cancellation, at the same time they've announced the 33 mil loss, because it just looks like all of that is one man's problem. It looks like the DLCs of a game being directed by this dude, and the studio that has lost load of money being directed by this dude, well, that dude is now gone. Do you know what I mean? It's like a scapegoat. And that's how I feel it is anyway. And this is the thing. I'm speculating as much as anyone else here. I don't. Besides the fact that the facts we've seen in the news, the rest is conjecture. It's what, but that's how I've seen things done before. And the thing is, this has happened to Tabata many times, where he's kind of been used as a scapegoat, and he's never complained. He's taken it on the chin. And it'd be really nice to see now if he leaves, whether he comes out and he tells the full true story about all of this now that he has left. And the reason why he has left, according to him, is because he wants to go work for himself. He wants to actually own his own business now. Whether that's still in gaming, I don't know. Whether he still wants to go and create AI so complex that it's like they have souls, I don't know. It could be. But what I certainly know, if he's going to be working at home, he's going to be with his family. and the fact that that was really weighing on him before the 15 situation, I expect that is a huge part of why he has left. And I'm happy for him, and I absolutely wish him all the best. I want to say thank you to him for everything he's done in the series. And the final point as to why I think he's left, especially to be his own boss, is because he hasn't allowed, and Square Enix haven't allowed him to put his own stamp on virtually anything. Like, he's not been able to take his own thing, really, besides Type-Zero, which, my favourite Final Fantasy. So the fact that's the only thing he's been able to direct and control himself, everything else has been muddied, mostly by Nomura. Everything else he's either had to pick up or try to fix, and he's had to take a lot of flack and blame for that, and he's been put on the back foot all the time, over and over again. And if you don't believe me on that, we'll just go through it. So in terms of what Tabbit has done, well, I'm going to go through the things he's directed specifically. He's on special thanks for many things like Dissidio NT and various other projects. But in terms of what he's done, so one of the first things he directed was actually before Crisis Core. The FF7 sort of mobile Turk game. Now, even that, he wasn't originally supposed to be directing. Before Crisis Core was originally going to be directed by Nomura, but because Nomura was too busy and too swamped on other projects, it got passed over to him, and he did a pretty good job on it. But that was not before Nomura had done a fair few bits of conceptual work and laying in some groundwork for it. That Nomura, Tabata then had to come in and build upon. Next, we move on to Crisis Core, which was once again exceptionally rigged in terms of most everything. The story had been written by Najima and Katase. The Last Order, the little kind of other seven compilation piece that came out before anime, even that was interfering creatively with Crisis Core, because some of the negative reactions that spurred to the story and some of the changes. So Tabata wouldn't have had choice there. In fact, he would have had no choice in terms of most of the story. He was brought on board to try to fix this, get it together, and basically almost be like just a project manager. You know, just a head, just somebody to point the finger at the top of it. You know, I'm not bullshitting it. Even Najima himself had said, quote, "The whole thing of Crisis Core had been cooking for 10 years. They'd already worked out the story, and, yep, you guessed it, Nomura had developed conceptual work down to the ground, most of which had first been envisioned as an action game, but Tabata pulled it back to a system that was more similar to ones found in RPGs, as the staff had more experience in designing them." So here we go, Nomura had this idea for what the system should be, but it took Tabata to pull it back down to ground to say, no, this is what we actually have the expertise to achieve. Where have we heard that before? Where have we heard that? Shit the bed, where? I mean, I'm not going to start roasting with Nomura, and by no means, if I came out in the defense of Nomura on most of this, I definitely could. This isn't a defense habit of shit on Nomura kind of thing. Nomura is a fantastic creative producer and creative influence, but that's what he is. He's not a director. I don't think he's director material. Oh, what about Kingdom Hearts? Blah, 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 blah. I ain't gonna go there. But I think they've constantly had Nomura too much at the head of the helm rather than where he actually fits in. And this is why we've seen Nomura keep having to pass off these responsibilities. And he's done this numerous times, and most of the time it's been Tabata in the backline. Even with Crisis Core, while we're still on it, even the combat system was getting influenced out of Tabata's control. The DMW system, the randomized system that had it in there, that element was added because of Nomura's enthusiasm for pachinko slots. Then if we just move on to the third story very quickly, Third Birthday. The story of Aya Bree was originally put forward by Nomura. In fact, the entire game was suggested by Nomura. Then they actually green-lighted it, but Nomura then said he was too busy with other stuff. So he personally requested for Tabata to come on because they had worked so well together before. Tabata became director. But then Nomura kept getting involved. Nomura said he wanted a higher level of realism for Tabata to achieve. Tabata had to tell him that's not even achievable on mobile games. So they had to shift it over onto the PSP, which then almost led Square... That actually led Square to order Tabata to concentrate on the Third Birthday more deeply, which then almost led to Type-Zero being cancelled the first time. the game that Tabata had wanted, the game that he had loved, the game that he had wanted to get out, almost got cancelled because of this other thing that Nomura had instigated. And that trend keeps on following. How many times did Type-Zero get delayed? Not even just bringing it to the West, even out in Japan. How much did we then have with the Type-Zero Online getting cancelled, getting renamed? Type-Zero Online into Type-Zero Geo. I can't even follow how many times Type-Zero got fucked about because it's just so momentously complex. And now we're in a situation where... Now we're in a situation where Type Next is probably never going to happen as well. Type Next, which Tabata definitely teased up and left so much story potential. So much it hurts. We're probably never going to see it. And in terms of what I genuinely think will happen with Type Next, I do think it's gone. I think there is no Type series without Tabata. In fact, Tabata was at one point before 15 really started taking off. He said that he actually wanted to make Type its own franchise. The Type franchise that would run alongside Final Fantasy. It's kind of like an offshoot franchise. Oh God, I want to cry so fucking bad. You're gonna see a 26-year-old man cry on stream. And then finally, I don't think I really need to tell anyone that Final Fantasy XV was originally Versus 13, directed and run by Nomura, until eventually he ditched it, dropped it, and lo and behold, it got passed on to Tabata again. And he has raised in the past about how tied his hands have been, creatively and decision-wise, in terms of what's expected and what's needed and what's demanded of him, and how every time he's tried to make his own stamp, it's been interfered with, it's been tampered, it's been pushed, it's been treated like fucking shit. And can I now blame a man? If I was in Tabata's shoes, if you was really in Tabata's shoes, and every time you wanted to try to make some sort of creative impact and stamp of your own, it got treated like fucking garbage. Yet the only time you was actually ever allowed to thrive was when you was picking up somebody else's shit, but then getting in turn blamed for it every step of the way from start to finish. He has been getting blamed for everything. And this is what I dearly want. Anyone who's listening to this, whether you're a lover of Tabata or a hater of Tabata, sit there and as a person think yourself, how would you feel if you were putting in that much work where you was abandoning your family, your health, your sleep, putting everything in and getting virtually no recognition? If you felt like your career up until this point was just being overlooked and being stamped on, and this is the thing, you don't really hear this side of Bat Tabata because he doesn't, again, like I said, he doesn't act the victim. He doesn't bemoan everything all the time. But when you actually dig deep and you go through this story, he gave 110% to this franchise. And honestly, what I think he did with 15 was phenomenal, was incredible. You know, a lot of these other decisions we blamed Tabata before. I was even watching, I won't name who he is, but I even saw it on his video when he was talking about Tabata, saying about, oh no, you've cancelled these DLCs, but you had time for a Forza collab, you had time for a Terra battle collab, you had time for a Tekken battle collab. Do you honestly think that Tabata is doing these collabs from a man who has done nothing but want to put his own creative stamp, from a man who, whenever he spoke about it, he said what he wants to achieve being a video game director and working within in this industry? Do you think he at all ever put on the list that I want to do really thrilling, fun fucking collabs with things like Assassin's Creed? Do you think he wants to do it? Do you think he wants to do, no, most of the shit with Cup Noodle? Did you really think Tabata was like, oh, you know what I really want? I want to put a fucking Barclays Bank sign on as many stores in EOS as I can, and I want the camping gear to be Coleman's. Do you really think he wanted to do that? He didn't want to. It's because 15 is a gross, bloated, monolith giant of a game that has racked up such a bill that most of these collaborations, most of these campaigns, and most of these events, they would have been contracted by marketing departments. They would have been contracted by higher-ups at Square Enix. They would have been told to him to do them. Now, I know Square Enix like to make a point of saying, oh yeah, when it comes to creative decisions, we're very free in what we give our directors. But that's in terms of creative decisions. In terms of business decisions, most of those would have been getting made for him, and Tabata would have been told what to do. He would have had these things put under his nose. And they would have been consistently interfering, consistently with what he wanted to do. I can see how much push he would have had to have thrown at Square when he was saying things like how he's really trying to encourage more DLC because he's not happy with the story. That's the thing. Tabitha from day one hasn't come out, like Rian Johnson from Star Wars, for example. He hasn't come out and he hasn't tried to egotistically defend his game. He hasn't tried to come out and say, oh, the fans just didn't get Luna. The fans just didn't get that. The fans just didn't get that. No, he said, I agree. And I'm really pushing Square because I want to try to get this stuff out. I want to. And when he's getting all of this shit that's interfering what he wants to do and then simultaneously getting blamed by idiotic fucking fans who can't see that, at the same time getting some of the diabolical stuff that I have seen some of you saying about this guy, you know, I've got to say, I am pissed. Because I've seen some of the comments, especially over this week, that I honestly just find disgraceful. And it makes me mad. If you can't tell, it makes me mad. If I put myself in Tabitha's shoes, even for a second, I think I would have jumped ship a long fucking time ago. Having to shoulder the blame for stuff that you didn't even want to have put on your shoulders in the first place, I can't even imagine the level of patience you have to be able to just swallow that with a shit-eating grin the most of the time that he has. So regardless of the reason he's left, whether it's the 33 mil, whether it's regardless, I think it's a huge culmination of issues. I really hope it was actually Tabitha just deciding to walk out the door, not putting his own foot down. But I even think that to a strong degree, when 33 mil is lost, it's not a case that a Square Enix high up walks in the office and goes, oh yeah, no, you've lost 33 mil, guys, better luck next time. That's not how it happens. They would have come in after that and they would have brought down the hammer. They would have brought down terms, conditions, demands, and I really expect they probably did, and Tabitha just heard it and went, you know what, screw this, I'm out. And you know what, however Tabitha decided to leave, I really hope he just did it in a kind of a, you know, kind of a that way. You know, I personally, for all of this, while I see Tabitha's errors and flaws, and while I think it's good that he's departed from the Final Fantasy series, and I said that 6 months ago, I said it's good, take a break, go somewhere else, do something different, and if you ever come back to Final Fantasy in the future, ace to me. You'll always be welcomed by me, Tabitha. But it's Square Enix I blame for all of this. Most of the decisions, most of the flaws, most of the royal cock-ups and higher-up decisions, they came from the top. They came from their top and they worked their way down. And if you can't see that, if anyone can't see that, if they honestly don't think that is Square Enix over Tabitha, if they think it's Tabitha over Square Enix, then how do you explain what else is happening in the franchise? How do you explain all this other diabolical shit that's happening within the franchise that has nothing to do with Tabitha? Because I can point to quite a metrics tons worth of it, really. We know that every shareholder, they don't care that if in the last year, like it has with Square Enix, that they've seen their sharehold price nearly double. They don't care. The share price can only ever inflate, it can never deflate, and they are the main customer of Square Enix right now. And I know that for fact because I can see the decisions and I can see what is being done within this franchise. Things like A 15 New Empire. Yes, I've mentioned it on my last 7 videos. I will keep mentioning it. Shit like that and the collaborations, they are all designed, and the game as a service bullshit as a whole, it's all designed because they want to see the share price keep ticking up, and it's simply not sustainable. There's never been a business on this planet. I don't know why businesses keep doing it. I don't know why they keep doing it. It's not sustainable, but they don't care. They don't care. And everything in terms of what the fans want, and even in terms of their own directors and how they get treated, get thrown under the bus. And the fact is, rather than blame that problem, and how that has a malignant spread that reaches down and has caused all these issues that we're seeing, like the cancellation of the DLC, if instead you find it more fulfilling and you believe you truly believe that it's actually better to blame the bloke who got thrown in a crappy situation on 3 hours sleep a day, then fine, be my guest. But I don't agree with you. I think you have the foresight and perspective of a fucking gnat. Oh, right, there we go. I'm done. I had to get that out. I know people wanted to know My view on the whole Tabbit situation, that is me freeballing it off of the top of my head, really. I don't think I've left out any facts in the story in terms of the DLC and the Luminous Studios. I mean, you can get that anywhere else. I just wanted to give my view on it. And I definitely don't want to leave this video off negative. I just want to say thank you to Tabitha. I absolutely adore Crisis Core. I love Type Zero. I'm sorry for what happened with 15, but at its core, I love it still. And I just want to thank Tabitha for the 20 years that he has been serving Square Enix. And 15 that he has been involved in the Final Fantasy series. I've never found a director more forthcoming than yourself, especially when it came to the ATR events, how you kept us updated with 15 despite all of its delays, how you always had an optimism and you always had a pride about your work and excitement. And just for me personally, I've never wanted to meet a director before. You were the first one. I should probably capture in some love hearts around this point. I've never wanted to meet a director before. You were the first one. I wanted to make it happen. And honestly, I was so nervous when I came up and I met him. I'm not a big bloke, but I'm 6 foot. I'm 6 foot. And at this point, I did weigh like 220 pounds. And he's just like a small Japanese man. You know, he's Japanese size. And I came up to him like a nervous wreck. I just wanted a little shake. And I kind of went to run away. But, you know, he pulled me back for a picture, had a chat with me, and honestly, that will honestly be, it'll honestly be one of my fondest memories. I felt the care that I've heard you express many times, the care that you've expressed for fans. I felt it firsthand, and it just saddens me that that care from so many supposed fans couldn't be extended back. I just think it was unreasonable what was expected, and it was unfair how it all failed out. And if anyone watching this can't agree to that, to some extent that it was unreasonable and fair how this all rolled down, well then I think you're unreasonable and fair. And it's another director that's gone from the series. I know Tanaka, I think it's Tanaki Tanaka or Takeni Takana, I can't remember the guy's name. I know he's taking over just the Arden DLC. I don't think he's going to be a sort of a full-time Final Fantasy director going forward, but we definitely need more in the franchise. We need new, fresh blood. And honestly, I think that it's going to be kind of hard, because if Final Fantasy isn't the most intimidating franchise to come on board with already, you know, one of the biggest, longest running franchises of all time, it's got to be. It's simply got to be. And the fact that Tabitha, though it might not have worked in the place of the fact you attempted it and you tackled it and you came at it with as bold and brave and innovative an attempt as you made on it, and some of those things definitely stuck, I think that it takes incredible courage to really go at a franchise as long running as this with all those fans up against your back, and to even dare to try anything different. And the thing is, guys, I think we just need to treat these situations better and more delicately, because whoever's going to come in place of Tabitha, whoever's going to go on to 16, whoever's going to go on to the 7 remake after Nomura inevitably drops it. I don't want to get sassy with Nomura, but I am right now. I think they're going to see this and they're going to be deeply intimidated about coming on as a director. And I actually think that the real creative ones, the real creative geniuses who really want to make their own stamps, they're the kind of ones who will avoid it, and the kind of directors who will take its place is simply the cash and career hungry mouthpieces who will basically do as safe and standard a formula and do everything Square Enix tells them by the book, and they will try not to rock the ship. And you know what? That's the kind of thing that could choke and suffocate the life out of this franchise. So next time you decide to go ranting on a fucking director for things that you haven't really thought through, just give it a little bit more thought and also give it a little bit more compassion. But that's all I've got to say. Let me know what you think in the comment section below. Until the next video. Cool.